did not create me to worry. You did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here. Help me say yes.
Amen. Can we lift him up this morning? Hallelujah. How many know he's worthy of our praise? Hallelujah. 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 Jesus, Jesus, you're worthy, Lord. Oh, come on. Can we keep lifting him up? Hallelujah. Jesus, you're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. Oh, we praise you, God. We lift you up, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. Amen. How many know he's worthy this morning? Amen. Can we just lift him up in worship and praise tonight, this morning? Can we just love him this morning? Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you're worthy, Lord. Oh, can we lift our hands and praise him? Oh God, you're worthy, Lord. Oh Jesus. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. Oh, can we praise him? Jesus, you're worthy, Jesus. Oh, I praise you, Lord.
Praise you in all that I go through.
Oh, Jesus.
Praise in what I do.
And I owe it all to you. You're worthy, Lord. Jesus,
I wanna be close to you.
Oh, bless you, Lord. Oh, can we lift him up and praise him? Oh, and I'll praise you. Oh, hallelujah. Jesus, we worship you, Lord. We lift you up, God. We lift you up. Oh, you're worthy, God.
In all that I go through,
praise is
what I do.
And I owe it.
I'll praise you.
Oh, whether I'm happy,
whether I'm happy or
sad,
I'll praise
worthy, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Praise is what I do.
And I owe it. Worship you, Lord. Doesn't even stand a chance.
I praise, I praise.
Thank you, Lord.
I bow to praise.
Oh, Jesus, we praise you, Lord. I'll praise you. Whether happy, I'll praise you,
praise you.
Oh, and all that I go through,
because praise is what I do,
and I owe it all. Hallelujah, you're worthy, Lord, you're worthy, Lord, Jesus. Amen, how many know he's worthy of our praise and our worship? Amen, can we just lift him up? Can we give him that praise he deserves? Hallelujah, you're worthy, Lord. You're worthy of our praise.
Every praise
is to our God. Oh, you're worthy, Lord.
Every praise
is to our God. Every word of worship, every praise, you're worthy, Lord. Oh, God.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship.
Every praise is to our God.
Oh, come on, he's worthy of our praise.
God, my Savior.
Oh, God, you're my healer. Oh, Jesus.
God, my deliverer.
Oh, yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Oh,
God.
God,
you're my healer.
God, my healer.
God, my deliverer.
God, my deliverer.
Oh, yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Oh, yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Oh, hallelujah.
Every
word of worship,
every praise,
every praise,
every praise, every praise,
every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God. Oh, you're worthy, Lord.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship,
in one accord.
Every praise,
every praise.
Hallelujah. Oh God, you're my healer. Oh, can we lift his name up? Hallelujah. Come on, he is. Oh, he is. God. God, you're my healer. God, you're worthy, Lord. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Oh, hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah
to our God.
Oh, every praise, every praise
is to our God.
Every praise, every praise. Every praise. All our worship, all our praise. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. Can we give him that praise? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord.
Lord, a sanctuary with our praise.
Come on, can we build him with our praise tonight? Let's build it up with our praise. For the Lord. Of his people,
let our offering be worthy.
Oh, we lift you up, Lord.
Praise unto
sing and shout. Can we bless that name? Jesus! Hallelujah! Throw both hands up to the sky. Worthy, Lord.
Worthy, worthy to be praised.
Let us build the Lord a sanctuary.
With
our
praise.
Hallelujah.
Dwell
among us. Come on, he's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah.
He abides in the praises of his people.
Hallelujah. Offering be worthy. Oh, lift your
praise unto
the Lord. Sing a shout. We'll bless the name
of Jesus.
Throw both hands up. Hands up to the sky.
One who dwells on high.
He's worthy of our praise. Praise unto the Lord. Can we bless his name? Jesus. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. Hands up to the sky.
Praise the one
who dwells on high. For he's worthy, worthy, worthy. Hallelujah.
Worthy, worthy
to be praised. Hallelujah.
Worthy, worthy, worthy.
Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord. Hallelujah. Can you lift him up? Jesus, you're worthy. Amen. How many know he's worthy? Amen. You may make your way back to your seats. Amen. Who's thankful to be here? Amen. In Matthew chapter 5, in verse 10, it says, "Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Verse 11 says, "Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake." Amen. If you're not getting persecuted, you're doing something wrong. Amen. It says we're going to get persecuted, but we're going to be blessed for it. Amen. And verse 12 says, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." Amen. Who has a testimony? Amen, Sister Michaela.
Thank you, Jesus.
But it
could become offended.
Sure.
It's just like not as much, like not trying to offend people as well. And I've been really thinking about that a lot. And it's, I'm just so thankful we serve such an awesome
God. Amen. Amen. Does anybody else have a testimony? Brother Kevin?
So, I'm just glad that even though I woke up at 9:55, I was able to get ready, get everything on, and just head down here. And I'm glad that even though I was late, I can tell the devil's fighting me, and I'm glad that God is here with me, just to stand by me, saying, I got you, don't worry about it. And I'm just glad that no matter what, no matter where, God is always with us.
Brother Conrad? Amen. Sister Erica.
You know, I'm thankful being in the house of the Lord. And you know, I'm thankful that God puts people in our paths when we ask Him to. So we were doing a fundraiser on Friday for the church, and me and Pearl went to the deli to get something for lunch for us girls. And we met a lady there, and she looked at us and she was like, are you guys Pentecostal? And we were like, yeah, we are. And then we kind of just sat there awkwardly for a minute, and then she started talking again. And she was like, what church do you guys go to? I go to the one over at the library. And we were like, oh, we go to the one on Elk Street. And we were telling her all about it. And then Pearl was like, yeah, my dad's the pastor there. And she was like asking a bunch of questions. We gave her a church card. And she was like, you know, I grew up Pentecostal. And she was like, but I might come check out your church. And, you know, I'm so thankful that God put her in our path, that we were able to invite her to church. And not only that, but also when we got her food, she gave us like a $6 discount on our food. So I'm really thankful for that as well.
Amen. Sister Natalia?
So on Wednesday, in the afternoon, my dad's car broke down, and we've been suffering with like financial issues for a while. And so like they told me about it, and like they were just stressed and everything. So I just went downstairs and I got mad. I was like, why are you doing this, God? Like, why? I was just mad. And then I got the story told, but it's like he used that car for like work. And so I was like thinking, and like the car broke down right by my house. So I was just thanking God, like it could have broken down the highway, the dirt road, like anywhere else. So I was just like thanking Him, and He said, like, I'm sorry for getting mad. And you know, He like, it was literally down the street, and you know, I thanked Him that my dad was safe and everything. And I kind of let it go and put it in God's hands. And I was gonna tell that to my mom and dad, say like, we should thank God that He's safe and everything, that car broke down right by our house. And as soon as I was gonna say it, my mom said it. And then they kind of like, they were okay, but you know, we didn't know how to move the car. So we called pastors that morning and came, so thank you. And it was kind of like a reminder, because I'm the type of person that's like, I don't need help, I'm gonna yeah. So it was just kind of a reminder that it's a process for help and to receive it.
Amen. Mom?
I'm thankful for a pastor who preaches the truth and will preach words that knock us out of our comfortable shell. And I felt like yesterday morning God spoke to me and showed me that when I was 1.5, my mom was put into a mental institution. And I was the youngest of 4. And sorry, it's been a struggle, but I need to say it. My dad remarried when I was very young, and he made us call her mom. He wouldn't let us talk about our mom. And so at a young age, I learned how to perform and what people needed to see and what people needed to hear. And so since I was a young child, I've learned to put on an act and not be real. And I didn't even know it myself until Pastor preached on Tuesday. And it was a really, really tough week, but God, He worked on me. I know He did. He talked to me yesterday morning, and it was the best day showed me that you started running when you came to church. You never learned to crawl. You changed everything. And Pastor even said how weird I am because I would change and I'd put on dresses and I was doing an act.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't even know until yesterday morning. And it was the best day ever. We went to Walmart and everybody smiled at me and talked to me. And then this morning I woke up and I was under attack. And I know I can get through it. And God's there for me. And I love you all. And
amen.
Praise God.
Amen. Sister Natalia. Amen. Is anybody else? Sister Michaela?
I just want to say, there's no mistakes. God does not make mistakes.
None
and
at
I
all.
Am so thankful how everything has transpired for me in this church and
Amen.
Be roommates with Nancy. And I am so thankful because iron sharpens iron, how much we learn from each other. And we're in this together.
Right.
Like you said earlier. We are, and I'm just thankful that we have people that want to go forward and that we can do it together.
Amen. Does anybody else? Brother Josh?
We gotta do those things. How are we gonna pray for it and not do it? You know what I'm saying? And when we pray for the Holy Ghost nudges you about somebody, just do it. You know what I'm saying? And there's really nothing to lose anymore. You know, we're at the end of times. And what's another soul for the church gonna do?
Right.
You know, it's only there.
Amen.
It's only up from here. And you know, I just feel in my heart that you know it's only up from here. There's no more going down. There's no more. We're not losing anymore. You know.
Amen.
We gotta just keep going and keep going, and these chairs will be filled.
Amen.
You know, as long as we keep going.
Amen.
Amen. Sister Mary.
Maybe something is going to shake up. All I know is God.
Amen.
At least according to his word, not Mary's word. Anyway, it sure looks like things are shaping up and rolling.
Amen. Nana.
Brother John, I am so thankful to be here today. I'm thankful that God can wake us up with people on our mind. Friday morning, I woke up with some friends on our mind, someone that my husband worked with at the mine. And so I thought, well, I'll go visit them today. So I went and I talked to her some about what Mary was talking about, things that's going on. And I left there and I was driving down the road. I thought, I came by the dollar store and I thought, I need to stop and get some graduation cards. So I stopped and I had a stack of graduation cards and I went to check out. The young man was checking me out and he said something about all the graduation cards. And I said, yes, I have grandkids graduating. He said, all of these? And I said, well, no, I only have a couple that's really my grandkids. But I said, all the rest of them are kids from my church and they're just like my grandkids.
Amen.
And he said, you know, I've been talking to my wife, and I told my wife, we need to find a good church. And I just happened to have a card in my billfold, so I got that card out, and I gave it to him. I didn't get a chance to talk to him because there was a lineup behind me. But I'm thankful if we walk with God, he'll lead us to the person that we need to talk to, and I appreciate him.
Hallelujah. Amen. Can we stand for prayer requests?
Amen. There's one announcement. If you're going to go to Women's Conference, the due date to pay is today. Amen. If you have a prayer request, I'll call on you. Sister Erica. Amen. Sister Lexi. Amen. Sister Natalia. Amen. Sister Caitlin. Amen. Mom. Sister, I forgot your name. Yeah, I just did. Yeah, Sister Michaela. Yeah. Amen. Sister Nancy. Amen. Sister Misty. Amen. Brother Jeff. Amen. Sister Michaela. Amen. Sister Misty. Amen. Brother Jeff. Amen. Sister Mary. Brother Conrad. Amen. Brother Isaiah. Amen. Amen. Brother Kevin. Amen. Brother Nate. Amen. Brother Chilo. Amen. Brother Ben.
For our youth group, for all the schools in this place, for Darwin, Brian, David, Stephanie, Josue, all the people who've been working with Bible studies, that God keeps revealing to them the truth.
Amen. Brother John.
My dad and my grandpa.
Amen. Brother Josh. Sister Erica. Amen. Sister Nina. Amen. Sister Pearl. Amen. Brother Orlando. Amen. Brother Jeff. Amen. If. Amen. Sister Michaela. Amen. If there's no other, can we take these before the Lord? Amen. Father, we love you, God. Touch every prayer request, God. Touch them, Lord God. Draw them in your name, Jesus, God. Touch those that are sick, God. Heal them in their bodies in your name, Jesus. God, touch those that have been touched in Jesus' name and that have been invited in your name, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen. And everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. If you got a tithe or offering, you could bring it up to the front. Amen. Shake your neighbor's hand and tell them you love them.
Lift up my soul. Can you sing it this morning? Oh, hallelujah. Start with praise. Can you lift your voice with praise? Feeling home. Oh, I'm going to thank you. Oh, come on. Why don't you lift your voice? Come on. Why don't you lift up your voice? My soul. Oh, I'm going to build. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, keep it going for a few seconds. Come on, lift up your voice. Oh, Jesus. Come on, you feel that? That's the King. Come on, that's the presence of God. Come on, you feel that? God can fix stuff. Why don't you open your mouth to Him? You feel that? That kind of tingling? Come on, that's the Holy Ghost moving. Come on, lift up your voice. Don't shut it down. I desire this more than anything else. Oh, Jesus. Come on, cry out to Him. Tell Him how much you need Him. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Why don't you thank Him for a few seconds for showing up? Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, you're so wonderful, King. You're so wonderful, King. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Every time we come together, that should be our focus. Get in the presence of the King into the building. And today, after this morning service, if you get it, there is no telling what God will do with you. I promise you that. If you don't get it, you will stay status quo, because I don't know how much more simpler the Lord can make it. The Lord has been talking to me, and I'm excited because it is mind-blowing. I want to welcome all our visitors, Kaylin and Ashley and Jasmini, Christian. I'm glad they're all here. Praise God. The church is growing. The Bible says in the book of Acts, the revival they had, that the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. And I want Him to add more. That means more work, but I don't mind. Turn me up just a little bit more there, Brother Isaiah, maybe in these monitors. I'll turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 10. I don't want to keep you standing for very long, but you... that's perfect. That maybe just touch it down. That's just about perfect. Make sure that Brother Richard can hear it. I miss him, but he'll be back soon. Pray for Brother Ryan, says Alexi, everybody that's missing. I'll just tell you this much. If we get this down, what I'm going to preach this morning, they ain't going to have a choice but to come. I promise you. I'm not just speaking about a few. I'm talking about everybody. People are going to say, go to the Rock Tabernacle Church. It is truly the church that is different. Praise God. Luke chapter 10 and verse 38. It says, now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. The wording here is just absolutely insane. He makes sure to point out Martha. She's a certain woman. And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha, this certain woman, was cumbered about much serving, and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her, therefore, that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, this certain woman, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful. And Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not, everybody say shall not, be taken away from her. I want to speak to you this morning from this thought, corporate-minded Christians. When we get to the end of this, I'll promise you this, that you do not want to be a corporate-minded Christian. If you are, you ain't going to make it. I promise you that. I want to upset everything you know about church. Everything you thought you knew is wrong. So let's pray. I mean, it might not all be wrong, but it's not all right either. But I want to help. God sent me with a word. Father, we love you. I'm asking you to touch every single mind. I feel your presence here. I'm so thankful. I am so thankful that you're here, Jesus. We need you more now than ever before. God, I'm asking you to touch every heart, every mind. God, sit next to each person, God, and open their understanding. God, help them to understand your word and what you would have them to hear. We ask it in the mighty name of Jesus, God, that you anoint us with understanding and revelation. Anoint my lips, God, anoint my mouth. Help me to say only what you want me to say. I ask it all in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. In Jesus' name, everybody said, you may be seated. Now this, the Lord yesterday morning, as we were driving, we went to take a trip. And if you've never seen the Bighorn Mountains, you are missing out. Even if you don't like driving. Steve, I drove across that pass. It was beautiful. The top of it was full of snow and drifts and blowing snow. But man, does God know how to build stuff. Praise God. He knows what he's doing. This morning, this subject, I sought the Lord while I was driving, thinking about this, what the Lord started to speak to me about, and I couldn't find a good setup, and I've learned in my time this far of being a preacher that if he's not going to give it to me, I better just go to bed. So we got home and went to bed, and I told my wife I'm going to get up in the morning and go to church, and I'm going to get prepared. I knew what God wanted me to talk about, but I just didn't know. I like to have notes. I don't like being unprepared. But sometimes he just makes me do things this way. And so I came down to the church, and the Lord spoke to me about Mary and Martha and wanted me to use this as a jumping off point. The reason it is because it's a perfect setup for what God wants this church to hear. Now, I'm pretty slow. Takes me a while to get something. I might look cool, but I was getting ready this morning. I thought the last thing is the most horrible thing I got to do and get ready. You know what that is? Comb my head, because I got to look at it. And I thought, I don't want to go look in that mirror and see all the faults that I've got, how I'm losing hair, and how that chin just hangs down a little extra lower. And I thought, I just got to hurry up and get to church. But God is, he's faithful, and I'm appreciative of him. Some of us are not getting a message. Now, I'm not here to be mean. Please don't think that. I have a purpose from the King, and that's to do his will. I want him to use me no matter which or what I do in life. Above all, I want him to use me. And so, I love Sister Nancy's testimony. She said, he just pushes us out of our comfort zone. Okay, I told Brother Ben, it's going to push them out of their comfort zone. You ready to be pushed out of your comfort zone? Seems like the Lord has had us in a particular vein. This vein that he has had... We have a great church. Let me just say that first. We have a phenomenal group of people. And it's people that God loves so much that he's preaching to us things that we need to hear. If you think I come up with this stuff on my own, you are taking medicine because you're high. I can't figure stuff like this out. And there's so much revelation that God has wanted to give our church. And he wants to do it because he's going to do a mighty thing in Rock Springs. that will shock and shake the entire world. And you're part of it. You are the bedrock of what God is wanting to do. So you're not here on accident. Every single person, you brother Christian, and you girls that have showed up this morning, you're not here on accident. There's a lot of people that aren't here, and we're sad about that. We wish they were here, but they're not here because the body's got to be ready. This text that we have read this morning is a perfect setup for our subject to talk about this morning. Martha was the go-getter. She had made, you need to pay attention. I don't want to keep preaching. Brother Jeff left. Come back, Brother Jeff. He's busy about the kingdom, but this is more important than anything else going on in this church. Here, I'll qualify saying. You ready for me to qualify it? Yes, everything that has to be done must be done. We've got to do a lot of stuff. But this, what's going on right now, is more important than anything else. Not because I'm preaching. I could give my notes to Orlando and let him preach them more. Give them to Brother Mark and he could preach them more. Brother Conrad. It doesn't matter who's preaching. What matters is that you pay attention to what God is trying to say to the church. This statement's been going through my mind. Is he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. Now, before we get started in this, I don't want to waste a moment of time explaining to you what I'm going to preach if your brain ain't focused. There's no point. It would fall on deaf ears. It would fall upon people that I got this to do, this to do, this to do. So I don't care what the preacher's saying, and you'll see why. Everybody paying attention? Okay, we got our Brother Jeff is back. We have everybody that's here. Martha was a go-getter. She had a mindset about making everything, make sure it was in the right spot. She had a mindset that dinner was prepared, that everybody had something to drink, that everyone was taken care of, that the floor was swept and the dryer was going and the faucet wasn't left on and all these things that would go making sure the bread was cooked just right and making sure the water was just the perfect temperature. If they weren't drinking that, maybe they had wine. Who knows? But Martha was all about the business of serving. She is the perfect model, this certain woman, of a corporate-minded Christian. What is a corporate-minded Christian? Pastor, well, I'm glad you asked. I'll tell you. What I mean by a corporate-minded Christian is that she was one that was more interested in the setup and functionality of the church. More important to her was that things were taken care of. She was making sure that the mission was being fulfilled. She had an idea of servitude and not worship. This, you think about this. Here, I'll help you. You ever heard of a corporate mission statement? Okay? Everyone has a mission statement. Let's take a look at a couple of these. Walmart's mission statement. You know what their mission statement is? Saving. This is the true mission statement. We always say it like this. Save money, live better. But the true mission statement that Sam Walton built when he first came up with Walmart, which was not called Walmart, it was called Sam's Club, is that save money, live better. Does anybody know what the Walgreens mission statement is? Walgreens mission statement is to champion the health and well-being of every community in America. What could be further than the truth with those two corporations? Honestly, okay. What about the mission statement of the Rock Tabernacle Church? What is our mission statement? The church that's different. Why is our church different? We're going to talk about it. What's the mission statement of Jesus Christ? Does anybody know right off the top of their head? Conrad? Okay. Okay. Repentance, okay. Well, yes and no. It's the King James Version Bible. But I think I found a scripture that sums it up. Put Ecclesiastes chapter 13, verse 12. Or it might be chapter 12, verse 13. I can't remember. I think it's chapter 12, verse 13. Turn in your Bibles. It's chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. This is the mission statement of God. Fear God, keep his commandments. Here's how we know this is the mission statement. For this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring into every work, or shall bring in every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. That's the mission statement of God, is seek him, make him first, fear him, keep his commandments. Everyone has a mission statement. You, every day you wake up, have a mission statement, whether you believe it or not. Ready for me to shake the foundations of your personal opinion of yourself? Is every single one of us get up in the morning and we have a list of things to do. Some of us are going to be jerks to everyone around us. Some of us are going to be absolute blessings to everyone around us. Some of us won't give people the time of day. Some of us are, we have a mission. We're going to do our own thing. And our mission statement conflicts with the mission statement of Jesus Christ. Well, it really does. I'm going slow on purpose. We may be here a while. You ready to be here a while? Everyone has a mission. Thank you, Brother Jeff. Everyone has a mission statement. But which one of these that we have looked at has held to the mission? Well, we know that Jesus Christ has, because he never changes. Let's dive into Walmart. Walmart's mission statement, created by Sam Walton back in whatever year he started, 1960-something. I think when he started Sam Clubs, maybe Sam's Club. Do you remember Sister Hawken? It was a long time ago. He started in Rogers, Arkansas. Anyways, the mission statement was about saving money, for people saving money by shopping at his store so that they could live better lives, so that they could spend their money, their hard-earned money, going out and playing, paying their bills, having a little more money at the end of the month than a little more month at the end of the money. It wasn't until he died that the mission statement changed. Last year, get this, Walmart, who in here wants to take a guess at how much Walmart profited just last year, 2023? Take a guess. Pardon? Over $1 billion. I'll take guesses. This is Sunday school. You ready to have your socks blown off? Last year, $147 billion is what Walmart profited. 2022, they profited $143 billion. Expected profit. This is not cost of doing business. This is gross profit at Walmart. You're where everybody loves to go hang out. Their expected projections for 2024 is $157 billion. In 1992, Sam Walton died, I believe it was. So I went back and I looked and I said, okay, what is the corporate money that they made in 1991? 1991, I wrote it down here somewhere. Maybe I didn't write it down. It was like $1.8 billion. You say, well, yeah, since then they've built more stores. They still made $1 billion. But back then, you could go to Walmart and spend $200 and not have enough carts to put it all in there. This today, you can go to Walmart and get out with one bag and it's a $100 bill. I got a purpose for all this. Is they have lost the mission statement. Not a year after he died, they were making $1.89-something billion in profit. That's the corporation. They swiftly went to $5 billion the first year. And he's only been dead since 1991. And now they're making $154 billion this year. $157 billion. Does it look like Walmart's kept to the mission statement? No, they sure haven't. They are a corporation. My wife and I and the kids, we went back to Rogers, Arkansas before we came here to pastor, and we went to Walmart's first store, kind of like JCPenney's and Kimmer's, just a little corner market. Yeah. We went there, and they have a museum dedicated to Sam Walton. Now, all of this is important so you get your mind on our subject this morning, is we walked in there, and the first thing that Sam Walton wanted to have happen is that if you walked into his store and someone was wearing a Walmart or Sam's Club, what do they call them things? Vest. Is that if you were not greeted and told, thank you for shopping at Walmart, that person would be fired on the spot. That was their mission statement. Now they put someone out the door to make sure you ain't stealing. And when you walk in the door, if you know them, you might get a hello. But according to the mission statement and what their whole project was, is they're supposed to, by going there, they should, you know, every corporation should make a little money. I get that. If I had a corporation, I'd want it to make money. But it sure seems like they've got greedy. I'm sure that they probably, who in here works at Walmart or has worked at Walmart? Okay, did they pay very well? Or do you still work there? No. Did you quit there on purpose? Yeah. You would think with $157 billion profit, that's after every bill is paid. The gross revenue is like $694 billion. So after all the bills are paid, after all the employees are paid, and insurance and everything that goes into running a business, they still are going to profit in projected totals $157 billion in the year 2024. That's pretty crazy. Seems like their mission statement has gone off. I have a purpose for all this, so stick with me. You'd think they could at least pay their employees a little better. That person's going to spend a third of their day there. And if they worked there for any year, amount of years, a third of their life. Something to think about. How about Walgreens? Does it seem like they're sure serving their mission statement? To provide for the wealth and health and well-being of every community of America? No, they peddle drugs. They're a pharmacist, a pharmacy. And you go in there and you pay prices that are like to Walmart's prices. We went to, where did we go yesterday? Was it Dayton? And we stopped at Buffalo and got gas. And I was like, it's real steep, but it's snowing. And I don't want to be on the freeway with half a tank of gas. So I got some gas and I was like, good Lord, $70 for half a tank of gas in that Suburban is a lot of money. My wife said, I want some Pringles. Went and looked, what was it, $9? Five something for a little box of Pringles. Well, Walmart's got at least the convenience store built because I think it's, what, $3 at Walmart? Maybe. I don't know. It really doesn't matter. But there's just a price to pay everywhere you go, it seems. Anyways, I don't know where I was going with that. Walgreens has some pretty steep prices, but they sell things like narcotics and drugs that are mind-altering. It doesn't sure seem like they're sticking to the... Their mission statement is to the health and well-being of every person in America. Now, do they have medicine that people need? Yeah, my brother has to take, what, 17 pills a day? Steve, you got to take quite a few. Yeah, there's people that need to take certain medicines that are helpful to their body. But then they have to take medicine to counteract the medicine that's helping their body. And so you get to like 18, 25, 35 pills. And it's like, what are we doing here? They're not keeping with the mission statement. What about the Rock Tabernacle Church? We're the church that's different. People come here, but then a lot of people don't like coming here. Why? Because we're different. Okay. Why are we different? We preach the truth. Okay. Okay, Conrad says we're crazy in the head. That's what they think. We hold two standards. We hold the holiness. We hold all these things, and people don't like that. Brother John got up and read scriptures that I was going to put in my notes, but I didn't feel like putting them in there. It's because he was supposed to read them. Yeah. It's just how I do things. As I had it in my mind, and I was like, nope, I'm not supposed to put it in there, so I just moved past it. And, you know, you're hated of all nations for his namesake. Yeah. Don't get upset at that. Blessed are ye when you're persecuted. Yeah. Blessed are you when you're being attacked. Yeah. Blessed are you when people will revile you and all these different things. But our mission statement, I think I want to change it. Why would you change our mission statement? Because we're not different. I don't really think we are. It should be something like this. We can have a vote later, maybe. I don't know. Maybe something like a spiritual hospital for those who are hurting. Or a place of rest for a weary soul. Something like that where it's like, what is our mission? What is our mission? What are we supposed to be doing? Well, we should be in submission to Christ. What is the mission of Christ? Jesus Christ. What did you just say? He's quoted a scripture that's in my notes, but he quoted it wrong. I don't want to go there yet, Brother Jeff, but it's going to blow your mind. Are you having fun yet? I am. I really feel like God wants to flip everyone on their head because we're not going according to his mission. We've thought it. I'm the pastor of the church. I've thought it. Boy, we're really doing it right. You know something that really shook me? It's Bishop Parker was dying, and it was just a few weeks before he died. Do you know what he said during one of his preachings? Somebody can go back and listen to all of them. He said this, he's sitting and preaching, and he said, "Are we even doing church right?" And that has shaken me. Do we do church right? What do you think, Brother Christian? You think we're doing it right? He's new. I don't want to put him on the spot. Do you think we're doing it right? Well, we're fixing to find out. I promise you that. The Lord showed me. But we haven't been doing it. We're different, yeah. And we get so proud that we're different. We've got holiness. We beat a drum. We're separated. We beat a drum. So what? That's not going to take you to heaven. People OCD can live in holiness. Here's somebody came to church the other day, and I thought they're literally Pentecostal. This is the first time they ever stepped foot in a Pentecostal church. You can look a lot of stuff. Something to think about. Turn with me to James chapter 1. I already talked all about that. What is the mission statement of Christ? Well, we hear a lot about religion. You better be paying attention. Don't be looking around and wondering. I've already done my research, so pay attention. James 1, verse 26. We hear about religion, and nobody likes religion. Who in here hates religion? Well, it seems like, yeah, Sister Michaela. This religion stuff that we're doing, preaching and doing everything we are in truth, yes, that is considered religion. And it is a bile to people that come and taste it. You remember the services, I don't want to get ahead of myself, where people walk in and they're not in here 20 feet and they're bawling. You know why that was? It's because we were doing it right, that service. Something to think about. James 1:26, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. Pure religion, according to the word of God, is undefiled before God. And the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself spotted from the world. James, the brother of Christ, followed his brother around. Let me ask you this question. I really want you to think. Do you think Jesus acted any different before he stepped on the scene? There was a span from the day he was born till he was 30 years old before he truly stepped on the scene. Who do you think was watching him the entire time? No, nobody was watching him. They didn't even know who he was. His mom and dad, his family. But there was one guy that I guarantee you was watching, and that was his brother James. Do you watch Gavin? Do you watch Pearl? You do. She went. She does. She tries to bug the fire out of her. Who in here watches me? Everybody. Who in here watches Brother Jeff? Okay? We are brothers and sisters in Christ. Every one of us are watching each other. Do you think Jesus acted any different before he stepped on the scene and got on the spot? Pay attention, girls. Don't be looking at. I understand you guys want to smile at each other, but this is not the morning to do that. I'm going to call you out. Pay attention. Because if you don't get this, you're going to miss it all for the rest of your life. I promise you that. Jesus, before he was even born, he filled somebody with the Holy Ghost. Did you know that? Who was it? John the Baptist. Or we call him John the Baptist because he baptized people. So God was working before he even took a breath of air that he gave himself. Hard to think about, but it's true. Yeah. And when Jesus stepped onto the scene, who did he spend all his time with?
sinners and publicans. Before he stepped on the scene, he probably spent a lot of time doing things that nobody ever saw. Because we see this in the Bible, we'll give you some ideas to go study, is he would do things before he was truly revealed, and he'd say, don't tell a soul about it. Don't tell nobody about me. It's in your Bibles. Go study it out. Look at me at Luke chapter 19. I want to take my time with this because I want it to sink in. Luke chapter 19. Here's another story. I want to take two scriptures here. This is the story of Zacchaeus. Before I read it, we're going to talk about this. Zacchaeus was a chief among the publicans. You can just hold right there at Luke 19. He was a short man. He was a thief. Everyone knew he was a thief. They hated him for it. They knew he was a sinner. It was dictated in the story. I just don't feel like reading all of it to save time. But he heard that Jesus was coming to town. And he sees the crowd gathering. And I'm sure you've heard the story. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. And a wee little man was he. It was a Sunday school song. And what's the rest of it? Up he went up the sycamore tree to see what he could see. I mean, it's a cool little jingle. But why did Zacchaeus do that? There was something about Zacchaeus that he desired and that God showed up to that city looking for. Brother Jeff, we're fixing to read your scripture that you quoted. You see it. Okay, well, this setting story here is quite the deal. Zacchaeus is short, and there's a crowd of people gathered. And he can't see Jesus, so he runs down the road. Here's how we know he runs down the road, because he climbs a tree, and the Bible says when Jesus came to that place. So he went, and he found a spot that he could get a hold of God. And he stood up on this tree, and he's watching the procession, and Jesus walks right up to him and looks at him and says, come out of that tree, Zacchaeus, for this day I got to go to your house. Paraphrase the story, you can go home and read it. And Zacchaeus comes down out of the tree. Do you know what the first thing that Zacchaeus said was? Let me go over to Luke. I didn't turn there when I told everybody else to turn there. What a guy. He says, look at this in verse. He says, Zacchaeus, make haste. Hurry up and get down here. For today, I want you to really notice the word, I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was going to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. What else did Jesus say to Zacchaeus than get out of the tree and show up over here because I got a visit with you? He didn't say nothing to him. Zacchaeus stands before the Lord in verse 8 and says unto the Lord, behold, Lord, half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. Didn't seem like he could speak very well either. Maybe he had a speech impediment. I don't know. But this is so interesting because Jesus says this in verse 9, this day salvation has come to this house. For as much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. What was lost? Was Zacchaeus lost? No, he found Zacchaeus. But there was something in here that God knew when he showed up to town. Just like he knew before you showed up to church this morning. Brother Kevin, I appreciate your testimony because there was a time when he would have just slept in, huh? But there's something inside of Brother Kevin that said, I got to get my height to church. And he said something so specific, he said, I know Jesus got me covered. When you got Jesus with you, he does have you covered. But God saw something in Zacchaeus that he desired from the very beginning. Jesus is there. And they have this moment, and he says, this day salvation is come to your house. But he first said, I'm going to abide in this house. This poor little Zacchaeus, he was a thief. And he knew he was a tax collector. That's what it meant, the chief among the publicans. I think the Apostle Paul must have heard about Zacchaeus, and I think Peter heard about Zacchaeus. I'll tell you why. But this is quite interesting when Jesus says that today salvation has come to your house. I think God was showing us something in plain sight that nobody has seen. Well, maybe they have. They just never said it, Sister Natalia. But think about this. Why do you think Peter said what he said in Acts 4:12? For there is no salvation under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Neither is there salvation in any other. I misquoted it. For there is none other name. And what did Jesus specifically say? I must abide in this house, and today salvation's come to your house. He was telling them, you get me, you got salvation. If you don't get me, you ain't got salvation. Yes, you have to do it right. And we are so proud to preach Acts 2:38, and you heard several people testify, we hear the truth and we preach the truth. Well, I'm preaching truth to you this morning. It may not be easy to hear, but this is something else. Zacchaeus was a sinner. Why do you think Jesus was talking about what was lost? It's because there was something that corporate Christians don't see. Corporate-minded Christians. Jesus saw something in Zacchaeus that he personally desired. Zacchaeus desired Jesus more than anything else in the world. He was already rich. Who in here has got lots of money that you're willing to go to your bank right now and draw as much as you possibly could and just give to the poor? Raise your hand if you'd do that right now. None of us. Even if you don't have a lot of money, it's because, well, this is all free. Even if you only have 28 bucks in your pocket, do you want to go take half of that and just give to poor people? Honestly, I mean, be honest with me. No, you don't. Neither do I. I'm being honest. I'm preaching just to you as much to you as I am, or as much to myself as I am to you. Get it all backwards here. Jesus was there, possibly, to find Zacchaeus. I believe that. But there was something that God desired that he had shut down at a certain time. This corporate-minded Christian that was there, you know what the writer Luke recorded them as? They. They saw it. They saw it, and then they murmured. Who's, look at God, who can do whatever he wants, going to see them stinking sinners, Zacchaeus, who stole my money because he lied about my taxes. That stinking IRS took my money. Think about that. Is this making sense? And he jumps down, and what's the first thing he does? Can anybody tell me what he did in verse 8? He repented. What I've got, I'm going to give half to the poor. So if he had $1 million, he gave $500,000 to the poor right away. And then what was left, he said, if I've stolen from any man. He knew he stole from people. That's what tax collectors do. They overcharge. Sister Nancy owes $1,200 in taxes, and that's the truth, but we're going to charge her $2,400 because we need our cut too. Right? He had stole from people. He said, I'm going to pay four times that. He probably didn't even have the money to pay it. You never know. But his repentance was so impressive to Jesus that he said, this day, salvation's come to this house. For the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost. Think about this. I believe that there was a desperate longing inside of the Lord, and he's got the same longing this morning with each one of us. In the garden, go back in your Bibles and go study this for yourself. He created everything. We'll put something in a paraphrasing of Scripture. Genesis chapter 1, verse 2 says that there was void in a dark place, right? Void and darkness. And have you ever heard that God is so big that the universe is in him? Okay? So inside of him, there was a spot that was missing. So he created the universe, and he put that inside that void. And then on side this earth, or on the side of the planet earth, he built a man named Adam. And what does it specifically say about the relationship between God and Adam? Can anybody tell me? Say it out loud, Brother Jeff. He walked in the cool of the evening. Every day. Think about this. I really want this to sink in. How many of you, if you had nothing else that was important in your life, would just walk with God? Adam walked with God every single day. Do you think at the appointed time in the cool of the evening, when Adam was alone, before Eve ever showed up, that Adam was ever late? Not one time. Because his relationship was with the king. He was fulfilling the void. And then God looks down and sees that two-thirds part of Adam's life, let's just say, maybe more, three-quarters, seven-eighths of Adam's life, was lonely. And he said, it's not good for man to dwell alone, so I'm going to make Eve, and I'm going to give him Eve, and she's going to help him. And then Adam shows up late. Maybe this started to become a thing. Well, now he's got Eve, so Eve takes precedence over the king, and so I don't really want to talk with God today because I'm talking with Eve, and, you know, I get home from work, and I got to visit with the wife, and I got to do all this stuff, and then I can go make time for God. Are you thinking? And then sin happens, and we all know what happened. It was Eve's fault, and we blame her to this day. It doesn't say that, though. It says because of one man, sin entered into the world. Because someone lost sight of the relationship. And I think Zacchaeus, on the worst day of his life probably, went, think about this. You get caught in a crowd as a short person, somebody's going to want to stomp a mud hole in you if you stole from them. In goes the knife into the back, and that little guy's not here no more stealing from us. Think about this. So he probably didn't want to be in the crowd anyways. He climbs up in the tree because there was something on the inside of Zacchaeus that was missing. It was a void that only God could fill, like a God-shaped hole. And so Zacchaeus climbs this tree and shows up at the right spot at the right time. There's people in here today that are looking for something. You don't even know what you're looking for. But you're in the tree. I can't see. Where is he at? I can't see through all the problems and all the different things in my way. And so you show up, and Jesus showed up looking for you too. You don't realize that. And this corporate-minded Christian are all of those that stood around and said, what is he doing going to Zacchaeus' house? Why would he care to go to Zacchaeus' house? What about Martha and Mary? Think about this. Do you know that when Jesus went to Zacchaeus' house, he was not alone? Who was with him? Nope. The disciples were. The Pharisees would not be seen with Zacchaeus. I ain't going to teach that Bible study. It's going to blow your minds. I'm not going to go hang out with that person because I have other things to do. I've got my schedule. I'm going to get so specific that if you walk away thinking it's not you, I'm the one you're talking. You're the one I'm talking to, and I'm the one I'm talking to too. In our text this morning, we know that Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus, but Martha was busy about whatever else was going on. The Pharisees had a corporate-minded mentality of, "We've got it right." They knew when to clap their hands. They knew when to say amen. They knew when to nod their head at the preacher in the good old Baptist nod. They knew how to walk across the aisle and shake their neighbor's hand and tell them that they loved them, as Brother Gavin instructed. And they did all these things. They knew how to, this is gonna hit, I'm pushing you. They knew how to testify about the things that they thought were important. Not about the king, but about what was important to them. Are you thinking? They knew that when someone asks you a question, you respond. They knew that during song service, we always run on the second song. I stood in the back this morning. It's funny to me, but I watched. It's my job as the watchman. When you think I'm not watching, I'm watching you. Who turned around and saw me? Bunch of people. You know what people were doing as I watched from the back? They were looking around the church. Who's here and who's not here? I'm here. By God, I've got my suit on. I've got my dress on. I'm making it about me so that people know I'm here. Why did we get dressed? Thank God we do. We'd have problems if we didn't. But why did you show up this morning? This is, I really want you to think, why are you here? Are you here because you go to church on Sunday? That's what you do. Are you here because you have a job to do? I'm a musician, so I must play. I'm a singer, so I must play. I'm the usher, so I must. I'm the greeter, so I must. I got to stock everything. Make sure everything's done. Make sure everything's right. But did you show up for anything else? Somebody think about. Jesus hated the Pharisees, I believe. Maybe hate's a strong word, but I really don't think he liked them at all. He didn't like them. Martha learned how to become a corporate Christian. I'll show up to church. Make sure the bathroom has tissue in it. Make sure the boxes of Kleenex are spread around. Make sure the cough drops are full. Make sure that there's water in the fridge. Make sure that the mirror's clean in the back. I've seen people wash the mirror during service. During service. What on earth is going on in your mind that you would go and clean or do something like that during a church service? What would make you do that? Does that make any sense to anybody? I'm going to straighten these. Somebody bumped the chairs when they were running, so we got to straighten them back out. No one cares. Only the attitude of a Pharisee. I've got corporate-minded Christianity. I'm going to show up to church and make it all about me. What about me? Did people notice I was there? Sister Misty's teaching Sunday school. Pastor didn't shake my hand. I'm not coming to church tonight. Or, I don't have anybody. You know what the Bible says? If you want friends, go show yourself friendly. If you think I'm going to come be your friend because you're sitting off to the side, you are high. I go talk to everyone. But if you put off the vibe that it's all about you, I don't want to hang around you. Jesus didn't want to hang around the Pharisees. Am I saying I'm Jesus? No. Not at all. But what I am saying is when you get corporate-minded Christianity in yourself and you say, well, I'm going to show up to church and everyone's going to know I was there because I sang the loudest. Why won't Pastor put me on the platform? How come he hasn't asked me to preach? How come he won't let me lead songs? How come he didn't give me a task? There's lots of tasks to do. Just go find one. How come nobody come and told me that I sang so well during song service? How come nobody didn't walk up to Brother Josh and tell him, you just shred on that guitar? You know what I tell these guys? They're like, dude, you're phenomenal. And I go, cool. You know who I do it for? I close my eyes and I sing off key and I sing loud and I rock out on that guitar because I don't care what you think. What I care is what he thinks. I've had him anoint me where I've never opened my eyes for over an hour and played. And they changed songs several times. That's because he was just helping me play. I was giving him what I had, and he was responding to it. But how many times do we walk in and we say, it's about me today? Does everybody know why I'm here? We get so concerned. Yeah, I'm talking to you. We get so concerned that the service must be conducted because that's what God cares about, and that's not what he cares about at all. Must it be done? Yes. But there's more important stuff. In the mentality of the corporate-minded Christian, we lose sight of his mission. His mission is to fill people with the Holy Ghost, to seek and save that which was lost. Sure, the mission statement is, fear God and keep his commandments. Well, if you're keeping his mission, you're under submission. Praise God, we've got a pastor that preaches the truth. I got to get better at it. I got to do better. Why? Because if we stay the same way, no one will come. Why did people flock in those multitudes? Anybody answer? You think they were going to see the disciples? What were they going to see, Brother Mark? They were going to see Jesus. Well, people don't want to talk to me. Why? Because you might have the attitude of a Pharisee. You guys see the vein that we've been in for several weeks now? Our church has to be different. Yes, I get it, and that's our mission statement. I didn't set it. It was set by Brother Walter and whoever made the vote that day. I want to be different, but I want to be different better. I want people to walk into our back door, pull into the parking lot, drive past on the freeway, and it's like a magnet pulls them in. Why are they? What are they? They sound like they're making a bunch of ruckus in there. But the feeling I get, I can't get away from it. I got to go there and check it out. People went to see Jesus by the thousands. Thousands upon thousands walked up and said, oh, we need something from the master. Yeah, a lot of them got what they wanted and walked away. We can do nothing about that. It's in history. But the Pharisees were there. You know what John called them? You whited sepulchers. What a generation of vipers. You bunch of snakes. That's what he called them. You'll bite and devour one another. You know a snake will eat its own tail? People lose the sight of the mission of Christ. Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. What did he lose? The Bible says, put up the song, or the scripture, no greater love. What's it, John 3:16? No greater love. Or for God so loved the world. Somebody find that scripture. Put up John 3:16 first. I know that one. What did God lose? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Did someone find that other scripture? No greater love hath a man. John 15:13. We got to take our time here and really dive into this, because what did Jesus do? He died on the cross for our sins. Hooray! We're so thankful for that, but his plan was much deeper. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man laid down his life for his friends. It doesn't say friend. It says friends. Jesus Christ, when Adam sinned, lost his relationship. He lost the one guy he could go to and complain about his day. You know, these dinosaurs are just being tricky. I'm going to kill them all. I don't know what God complains about. But I should. Something's been on my mind the past few weeks. Have you ever studied how many times Jesus was alone? It's in the Bible, and he was alone a lot. It bothers me. And let's drill it down a little closer. How many times is, during one day, is Jesus alone in your life? It says no greater love. Well, I love Jesus. People stand up. I love Jesus. Sister Mary said this morning, I love the Lord. We have all this love for him, but it's only Sunday and Tuesday because we got corporate-minded Christianity. Adam did all his work and went over and hung out with Jesus, and then the moment he got a distraction, Jesus went on the background. He got put on the back burner. God walked this planet and he said, I want someone to talk to. Let me just stop here and say this. Brother Richard impresses me. Has he talked to anybody and told you how he prays? Sister Kathy, this blows my... every time he talks to me and tells me how he prays, I just sit there and just stare at him like in wonder. Where did the mentality come from? Has anybody ever heard him talk about it? No, Sister Kathy has. What does he say? He'll go have a conversation with Dad. That's pretty personal. I go to Dad, what do you want to do about this? How many times we come in and we got our laundry list of things. God, do this, do this, do this, do I love you. God, do this, do this, do this, do this, I love you. God, do this, do this. When he desires something so much deeper. And he wants it from you. He wants it from Orlando. And every single person that's under the sound of my voice, he is desiring something from you that he took away from himself. If you want to be in his mission statement, you got to lay down your life for him. That's what repentance is all about. I love Jesus, but I refuse to lay down my life. So I'm going to be a corporate-minded Christian, and by God, he's going to love me for it. No, he don't. I don't think he loves it at all. Why do you think he says in the end times when judgment day is going to happen that he's going to look at people and say, who are you? Come again? You really? You did all that in my name? I don't even know who you are. So he's going to tell people. People show up to church. She was the more like Martha, the corporate-minded Christian. I'm going to work. I'm going to do everything necessary in God's house. I'm going to make sure that people, the new people, have a card to sign. I'm going to make sure the new people have a water. I'm going to make sure that the cough drops are stocked. I'm going to make sure that the Kleenex boxes are not empty. I'm going to make sure that the songs are done right. I'm going to make sure that the music's just right. I'm going to make sure that everything happens as supposed to happen. When they walk through the door, I'll greet them. And who cares about worship? Because we're doing service. Is this really helping or hurting you? Is it causing you to think, what are we here for? If we get him here, they ain't going to have a choice. They're going to flock by the thousands. Do you think it's more interesting for people to come in? I did a little test this morning. Okay, I've been here a lot. I don't need a visitor's card. But I walked in, and I stood at the back, and I assumed myself to be a visitor. And lots of people. Second song, just right on cue. Before the first stanza of the lyrics were kicked out, vroom, running the aisles. And I watched people just run out of service. Not because they were showing they were worshiping, but it wasn't from the heart. Is it hard to hear? It's because God is wanting to talk to you this morning. He gave this to me to give to you. Because how many times do we walk in and we do the old same 6 and 4? We got to do just right. We got to have this just right. He doesn't care about that. Do you think, honestly, God cares if the lights are on or if the lights are off or if the chairs are straight or if the drinking fountain has been cleaned during cleaning time? Do you think he cares about that stuff? He wants things done decently and in order, yes. But what is more important? Let's go back to our text. Luke chapter 10. I want you to get this, and I know I'm taking a very long time, but we have got to get it. It's going to change the tenor of this city. If this church will get what I'm preaching this morning, every single person that needs the Holy Ghost, if you don't have the Holy Ghost this morning, if this church will get it, everyone will be filled with the Holy Ghost. God already showed me that. He won't have a choice but to move. Luke chapter 10, it says, now when it came to pass as they went, he entered into a certain village and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. She had to have everything perfect. Jesus was there. I've got my worship right. I've got my hand clapping right. I've got my testimony right. I've got my prayer request right. I've got all these things. I'm doing it just right because he's here and he's in service with us. And so I've got to make sure it's perfect. We've got to make sure pastor has everything he needs. You need anything? No, I don't need nothing. Go back and focus on the king. What about Jesus? Mary sat there. She didn't move a muscle. I watched it this morning. People that were trying to worship, people looked over at him. What were they looking at? Well, they're not jumping. We're supposed to jump. The song leader said jump. I don't know if you said jump this morning. I can't remember. But this is what it happens in our churches. We look around and there's somebody that's truly worshiping him. They're at his feet. And they're saying, whatever, I'll leave it all behind for you. I just want you to come down and get inside my heart so I can feel the presence of the Holy Ghost all the time. And the Martha mentality, the corporate worship mentality. You notice that we even call it corporate worship? Have you ever heard that before? Preachers say it all the time. We need to come together and have corporate worship. Why is the corporation involved? Cooperation worship, maybe. Not corporate worship. Martha walks in. Sister Nancy was a manager before. I've managed lots of people. Have you ever seen the Sister Nancy where the people that are doing the job, doing it right, they've been there longest, and the new person shows up and they're not doing it quite right, what do? They complain. They walk up to the preacher. Have you seen so and so? They're doing this. Why do you think I have such a bad attitude with people walking up to people and saying, you got to change this and 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 this? Because that's not what God's after. Man looks on the outside. What does God desire? What's on the inside? Every one of you can walk into this church and go through the motions, because this is what God is showing me. There's people in this church still doing this after I've preached about Pharisees and all these different things for several weeks. There's people that are still doing this to him. You know what he did to all the Pharisees? He left them behind. He always took off and went to wherever the sinner was. Who do you think he's going to come visit in the church? Those that are so concerned about, well, why didn't somebody shake my hand? How about why don't you go show somebody else some love and shake their hand? Greater love hath, put that scripture back up there, 15:13, John 15:13. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man will lay his own. You'll lay down your own attitude. I watch it every single service. Let the youth worship. Sister Nancy and Sister Michaela are the only ones that come to the front. Sister Mary will come. She'll stand three or four rows back. Other people stand in the back. Let the youth do it. What about your worship? Let them do it all. I'll tell you where God's going to go. He's going to go with the youth. Well, I'm here. So what? I made it to church. We got the mentality of put the time in the time. You remember little punch clocks? Or now it would be digital punch in the... How'd you guys sign in there at Exxon? Was it a punch clock? Did you even have to sign in? Card at the gate? You had a card at the gate? Originally. How about FedEx? What do they make you do? Use a badge now. That's how they did it at the hospital. You walk up, clocking in, scan the badge. That's how people come to church. Clock in, scan the badge. Do you see me? I'm here. Well, thank you for being here. I love it when a lot of people are here. Turn with me to, I'm going to go way to the end. Psalms, no, John chapter 4. Is this making sense to you? I want to turn this upside down on its head. I'm going to go back. John chapter 4, verse 21 says this. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. You don't even know why you're here, but you're here. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. This is what they're saying. But the hour cometh and now is when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. What is that talking about? That's talking about someone that is not a corporate-minded Christian. Go back to Luke 10. Martha's doing all that she's doing, making sure that everything's just perfect. The water's just right. Kleenexes are taken care of, and cough drops and toilet paper and paper towels, and the kids, they're taken care of. They're not running around making noise, doing all this stuff that's the setup that we think he wants. And Mary, one thing is needful, verse 42. And Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Mary shows up. You know when Lazarus died? Do you remember that part of the Bible where Lazarus died? Do you know where Mary was? No, she wasn't at the feet of Jesus. It's so crucial. That was Martha. Lazarus died. Whoever testified about being mad at God for a second this morning, who was that? Sister Natalia, thank you for saying that, because this is what God showed me. Is Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, and brother and sister, right? They're all in the same house. Martha, Lazarus dies. Jesus hears. They walk up to Jesus and said, Jesus, the one you love is dead. And he said, don't worry, he's just sleeping. They didn't even trust him at it. We know he's God, but he died. Martha, so corporate-minded, runs out to God and says, you dirty rat, my brother's dead. Shame on you for not being here. That's what she was telling him. If you would have been here, he wouldn't have died. If God, he was there. He's everywhere, all the time. But do you know where Mary was? This is just insane. It says Mary sat in the house. So let me find the scripture. I got to show it to you. Oops, I just messed something up here. John chapter 11. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that, verse 20, that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat. What is that word? Still in the house. Martha says to Jesus, Lord, this is verse 21 of John chapter 11. If thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. She's out there upset at God, running around like a chicken with her head cut off because her brother died, and shame on God for not showing up. She missed it. Because she says, Jesus tells her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said to him, I know he's going to rise again, I'm paraphrasing, at the resurrection in the last day. And he said, I'm the resurrection. Salvation is here today. If you get me, you've got it all. And she still didn't get it. She said, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, Son of God, which should come into the world. And she, when she had said so, she went her way. Verse 28. And called Mary, her sister, secretly saying, the master has come and calleth for thee. How many times you see people that are so interested in living for God, they don't care what people think. And God's just taking them here and taking them there, using them here, using them there, doing things like this. And you're like, well, what about me? Why is nobody focused on me now? It's because you made it about you. You ain't made it about God. This same Mary and Martha, Mary sat still. What's that scripture say that's out on her wall? Be still. I think it's out there. And know that I am God. Mary sat there at the feet of Jesus. You got it handled. I'm not worried about one thing. I kind of believe that Mary was sitting in the same spot where Jesus was. Just right at the same spot she was when Jesus took off. Because she knew. It doesn't matter. He's got us. He's got us covered, Brother Kevin. She was in there probably worshiping him. And then he shows up on the scene and she's so busy worshiping him, she said, Jesus, Martha said, Jesus is looking for you. Something to think about. Jesus paid the ultimate sacrifice for you. We watched this wedding happen yesterday, and I was observing the corporate Christian mentality. We've got to do this, we've got to do this, we say this, we say this, and there was no care for the love of God. They're all went right back to their lives. It made me think. Because God had already been talking to me. It made me think, what about us? We're the church that says we're different. But where's the power of God? When people walk through the door at our church, what hits them when they walk through the door? They got good music. Or maybe they don't got so good music. Or, wow. Why is that person weeping? Hey, hi, we're having church, come join us. And you go right back in, and Sister Michaela is the greeter, so she runs out and shakes her hand, and instead of standing there and giving their life's diatribe, she runs, that means their life story, she runs back into the church, said, come on, come worship with us. And she's like, you're cool, thank you for being here, but I've got to meet the King. Think about that. In your life this morning, I think we're at an impasse. We've got to change. Just because we show up to church doesn't mean we're doing it right. So many of us show up to church and punch the clock. Show up to church and punch the hour of prayer. Show up to church and punch the day of prayer, the day of fasting. We clap and sing and look around. And why isn't Brother Jamie jumping like I jump when I lead service? I'm just making stuff up because I looked at him. Think about this for a second. Why are we here? What should be more important in your whole life than worshiping the King? People say, well, I've got Jesus in my life. Are you sure? Turn with me to Psalms chapter 22. I want the musicians to come this morning. Psalms 22 says this is so important for us to hear. And I hope I'm making sense, and I know I'm taking a very long time, but this has got to get in your brain. God is already working, and he's trying to draw you closer. Some of us need to go home and erase our schedule. Some of us need to stop punching the clock. There's some stuff that we've got to work on. Psalms 22:3 says this, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabits the praises of Israel." We are spiritual Israel. You want God in your situation? Do you want him to fix those things that you got issues with? Then you got to get stuff off. You got to, just like Zacchaeus, you have showed up today with a purpose. I have got to see Jesus. The preaching's cool. The foolishness of preaching. The songs are needful. This is all a setup to get us to this moment. What are you going to do? There are some of you that aren't, I really believe this, that you're so focused on your corporate-minded mentality of living for God that this service is almost over and you're already off doing something in your mind. You're not even paying attention. I got to do this and this. Tomorrow I got to go here. This is because you're making it about you. And the king's looking at you saying, "What? How about you fill the void in my life?" Jesus came, put up that scripture in John again. Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. He wants to, think about this. When he kicked Adam out of the garden, he lost that piece that was just perfectly sized for his own heart. And then he created billions of people on this planet. Each one of you extremely unique. Steve's DNA is completely different than Natalia's DNA. Mark's DNA is completely different than Nate's DNA. And each one of us are a little shape that is there to fill his void. Let's all stand. If you get what I'm preaching, leave it all behind. Yeah, we have to do stuff. That's part of life. But you got 2/3 of your life to do that. And he's just asking for just a little bit. Think of what he asked of Adam. Just the cool of the evening. Where Adam would meet with him and walk with him. And so many times I've got this to do, this to do, this to do, this to do. You wonder why? Think about this. I'm going to use my wife as an example. My wife and I's relationship. My wife operates. She wants my time. And I'll give her time. What? It's funny. I'll give her time, but I won't be there in the time. Does that make sense? You see that? What about God? He wants you. Well, I'm here. No, you're not. You're there. You ever heard the lights on, nobody's home? That's what this church has got going on. God wants to bring in so many people. But if the light's on and no one's home and we've got the corporate-minded worship of, we'll come in, make sure all the chairs are taken care of, the light switches turned on at 10 till, shut the music off right at 2 minutes, get worship. What's more important? When we started, before we started preaching, did you feel the mood change in the room when everyone was collectively worshiping? That wasn't because I was at the platform. That wasn't because my voice was speaking. It's because every single person at that moment in time started worshiping him at the same time together from the heart. And he responded just like that. This morning, he wants to be with you all the time. Too many times we punch the clock in. We clock in and then we clock out. And the rest of our day is completely ours. Let me tell you what the Apostle Paul says. Put up Colossians chapter 3. I know you're standing, and we're not even close to being done. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. The Apostle Paul said this about the rest of our lives outside of living for God. of a side of service to him. Whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. If you came here thinking this morning that showing up to church was going to impress me, I'm already not impressed, because I didn't show up to try to impress you. I came here because I want to impress him. Because if I don't get Jesus Christ to go with me wherever I go, I'm a mess. I'm a mess already. And if you want him to be with you, you got to do some stuff. Why did Jesus tell Zacchaeus, this day salvation's come? It's because Zacchaeus, with his entire life and all the money he had, he looked at Christ and he said, I desire you more than I desire the rest of it. What do? Well, I got to go to work. I got to go to work. I got to pay my bills. I got to eat. I got to drive. I got to see the repetition of something. I got to do this because Rocky Mountain Power. I got to do this because Dominion Energy. I got to do this because of Verizon or Straight Talk. And you make it, whose image are you serving? He said, don't even serve an image, serve me. Mary had it figured out. She did not have corporate-minded mentality when it came to worship. Mary had to live with Martha afterwards. Do you think she cared what Martha thought? Not a bit. I think that Martha was so furious with Mary, she probably thought, I'm going to get back at her. I'm going to go home and gossip about her to my friends. That stinking Mary just sat there while I was doing all the work. Well, Jesus said, that shall not be taken away. Let's read on in Colossians 3. Knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Don't do it for men, because you ain't getting a reward for me. If you show up to church because you're hoping that someone will shake your hand, you showed up for the wrong reason. If you showed up to church because you think you impressed me or my wife or Sister Hawkins or whoever else, you're doing it. Why are you here? I showed up for him. This morning, we're going to do it a little bit different. You can stand where you're at or you can come forward, whatever you want to do. But we need to take what we've known. Yes, we must live in truth. Yes, we must fear him and keep his commandments. I'm not negating any of the truth that I've ever preached. But if we're doing that and we ain't making him the focus of it, we missed it all. We might as well close the doors, never have church ever again, because all we are is corporate-minded Christians. I want a move of God so powerful that chains break, not just for our city, but in the region. That people walking down the street feel something and go, wow, who is that that just walked by? My wife and I were at a place and this lady walked up to us. And I didn't say much, but I felt the Holy Ghost show up. And she started bawling immediately. Why? I'm making it about him. So tonight, this morning as they sing, don't look around. Just close your eyes. Between you and him, make it about him.